viajamos hasta Roma, Italia, y le agradezco mucho al profesor Pampanin que, pues siendo las 5, casi las 6 de la tarde en Roma, nos pueda acompañar. El profesor Pampanin es profesor de la Universidad de Roma, La Sapienza, y nos va a presentar una conferencia hacia que se titula como hacia el desarrollo de un plan nacional para integrar la rehabilitación sísmica con la energía, la eficiencia energética en escuelas. Muy bienvenido, Estefano, muchas gracias por acompañarnos y adelante, por favor, con tu presentación.
Thank you very much, Sergio. Muchas gracias to you and everyone of the organizing committee. I'm starting my video. Let me see if it works. It should be here.
Perfecto.
Yes, I would like to start also my video, if they allow me, please. Not only the presentation, but also my video. It's easier to show my face to be, there you are, there you are. Excellent. So thank you very much again, Sergio, and to everyone. It's an incredibly useful workshop. So I was extremely pleased when Sergio mentioned that you were already organizing it, and it would have been nice to share our experiences and discussing the trends. I will be wearing two hats. On one hand is my homeland hat, which is Italy. On the other one is my adopted hat, adopted country hat, New Zealand. I've been there for 16 years before coming back to Italy. And so it will be important to see what are the trends at the international level, not only from the seismic point of view, and not only from a country like New Zealand or Italy, but looking at co-creations and suggestions that have come from one country to the other. Specifically, we've been discussing in the workshop, it was very good to see a discussion about performance-based design, resilience, schools, retrofitting. We are all in the same problem path, in a way, in the same ballpark, in the same problem path. The idea will be to look at what's going on in terms of assessment and retrofitting strategies, code, financial incentives, and new trends to combine the resilience from a point of view of energy efficiency, seismic resilience, and the sustainability can become both from the energy efficiency point of view, so sustainability by energy efficiency, but also sustainability by not having to spend energy and resources in terms of repairing existing buildings. So the moving, let me see if it works. I'm trying to move ahead. There you are. We're living a common problem. It's a common problem worldwide. If we look at seismic regions, it's becoming so much easier than only 20 years ago to be able to share information. And so that's exactly what we need to do. It's our duty to be able to stay on the top of the knowledge worldwide and disseminate the knowledge, not only to technical people, but also, and more importantly, to the non-technical people. Just today, I had a class with my students, which I invited to link, to connect, because we are really discussing the mission of engineers to be able to enter into the public arena and able to move up, raise up the bar in terms of seismic safety, resilience, energy efficiency, and so forth. We well know the issue of seismic risk. We well know that seismic risk is a combination of hazard on one hand and vulnerability. We do know that the hazard is the part that we cannot change. We do know that the vulnerability is the only major component that as engineers and as citizens of different countries, we can modify and improve. So our duties is to understand as much as possible the vulnerability, and for how easy and obvious this statement looks like, the population don't think like that. So the population thinks that the earthquake is the problem. They don't think that the building is the problem. And in the technical environment, we always mention that the killers are the buildings. They are not, it's not the earthquake themselves. If we switch to our mathematical minds, engineering minds, the same seismic risk, look at this, becoming upside down, we put correctly capacity first. So the first the push over the left-hand side is showing the capacity of a building, and depending on the mechanisms, will be lower, higher, and we need to improve it. On the center side is the one that we cannot control, or we control the least. So it's basically the hazard. But it's important that we take into account when we do retrofitting, the uncertainty coming from the earthquake should not become suddenly a major issue for our retrofitting. To say in a different way, we cannot just retrofitting for a specific level of seismic hazard, but we need to improve the redundancy. And as we know, redundancy is a concept that in new design we use it, but it's a concept in the 1950s, 60s, where most of our post-Second World War buildings have been built, including schools. These concepts were not familiar. And so retrofitting an existing buildings have to take into account also that. If you look at the performance base that Greg was mentioning, that performance-based earthquake engineering, the basic concept worldwide accepted is still there in terms of four levels of earthquake intensity or probability of exceedance that we are looking at, and four levels of damage state. What is the problem? People do not know that this is only a reference. It's not a target, but it's a basically minimum by low expectations or minimum by low performance that we want to achieve. In other terms, everywhere in the world, residential buildings will be treated as a importance level two. And for that type of residential buildings, we will be focusing to have life safety performance, so extremely heavy damage to the point of non-repairable, for a 10% of probability of occurrence in 50 years earthquake. If we go to a school, the question should be, what level of safety we think is appropriate? Should we consider a school as important as a hospital? Population will say yes. But this is not what everywhere in the world has been implemented. So schools not everywhere in the world are mandatorily considered as important as an hospital. And so this already is an important debate. More importantly, when we do retrofitting or when we think about the target performance, we need to remember that life safety enters into the irreparability. So if a building is being damaged to a life safety point of view, as per design of a new building, it will be very likely not to be repairable. And so the cost of repairing is going to be significant. We are discussing about 50%. I was very pleased to see that from ANCRI and from Taiwan, you guys are able to get a 10% of retrofitting target or cost when compared to the new construction. Typically, the numbers, at least in Italy, are much higher for a number of reasons. And we're discussing about 30, 40, 50% of the cost of repairing of a building after damage. And similarly, of retrofitting, depending on what level of target we are achieving. So totally agree. We need to get to a standardized, unified, performance-based philosophy with manuals, and again, country-based, that's not easy to be achieved. This is something else that for an engineering point of view, it's extremely obvious. We do know that in a pushover analysis, our school will not look like that, and we are typically targeting the life safety objective. So we need to explain to people that it will not cost too much more, so only a few percentages, the retrofitting, which is raising the bar higher and allowing our building to stay in a operational level. Downtime is fundamental. Downtime for a school in a community, in addition to life safety, is fundamental to preserve the community opportunity to work. Family can work if their kids are at school. Well, I was mentioning the same today. It should be said that the COVID, the emergency, health emergency has been improving the distance learning, so the distance communication. So in a way, we have a backup plan that we did not have in the past, the opportunity to have a distance learning for a few months. It cannot go for much longer, also for schools. Let's look at what is seismic resistant in the way that we think as engineers or technical people or politicians in the specific area, and as people think from the normal community. We take a very well-designed building. We are in New Zealand. Post 80 means very well-designed, capacity design, poly, park and poly and Priestley. The plastic hinge will form in the beam, and here you are. That's what one of the most unique example of a well-designed building subjected to a very strong earthquake. And the plastic hinge is there to show that the building performed as we wanted. It's a life safety objective. The problem is that the cost of repairing of those plastic hinges all the way along the height of the building is extremely high. So basically, what we think is a good objective, and this will be a video, but I don't need to try to perform it. Let me see if it works. This is the modeling that we are today able to do. It's actually 10 years ago already. But in the past, people were not able to reproduce that level of damage. So just imagine to show this level of damage to the director of a school and explain to the representation of the families, so the parents, that this is going to be exactly the condition of your school if you manage to retrofit them to the level of demand, capacity ratio, demand ratio of a new building. So you're going to achieve life safety. Life safety is going to mean plastic hinges. Plastic hinge means repairing is going to be very expensive. So to the minimum, you're going to have an extremely heavy, excessive downtime. And more importantly, you might need to have a demolition. This is the story of New Zealand after the earthquake in 2010, 2011. Where many buildings, quite modern, well-designed, capacity design-wise, were not be able to repair economically and were demolished. There was also an insurance, a private public insurance scheme that was somehow helping, unfortunately, this process of demolition to occur. But it's important to know that the cost for the country is humongous. In New Zealand, we had 185 fatalities. It could have been much more than that. The city itself was made of 450,000 people. So we could have expected with the February 22nd, 2011 earthquake, we just passed the 10th anniversary of that earthquake, which was a major one, basically destroying the CBD, the central building district of the Christchurch, the second city in the country. And more importantly, additionally more importantly than the victims, which is irrecoverable as a result, is the $40 billion, just managed to think about $40 billion, but for a 4 million people country. So this has been a 24% of GDP. No country in the world would have been able to recover from such a national losses. And who pays the losses is either the government, which means taxpayer, or in this case, a very specific private public insurance, EQC, earthquake commission schemes, which allowed the country to recover because there was an injection of cash money from the reinsurance from all around the world, Munich Re on the top, to reconstruct how, not as it was, absolutely not as it was, possibly where it was somehow, but not as it was. So we are discussing a safer and resilient community, and you can bet that the population is now very well aware of what safer and not safe means, the relative terms of safety, and what resiliency means. If we go to the point of resiliency, Greg has mentioned that has been quite a fundamental movement from the concept from other disciplines into the earthquake engineering community, into the civil engineering, infrastructure engineering community. And people are now aware that downtime is fundamental, that the impact should be reduced. And in addition to that, it's fundamental to be able to get not only a much lower level of impact, but also to be able to recover promptly. Because the time of recovery, which at the end, the impact and recovery makes the area, of the jump down or the impact is actually the one that we have to modify. There are some metrics, but we are far away from having these metrics applied at a government level or at a national level. Let's take our seismic resisting building. It's a skeleton with a full envelope, and we well know that the skeleton is going to be damaged. We well know, but people don't think like that, that the floors, the diaphragms will be damaged because they are not rigid as the software would suggest. We are going to have no structural elements, either external or internal partitions, heavy bricks, clay bricks, like you do have in Mexico, South America, South Europe, and in some parts of also from Asia. In other countries, clay has been substituted in terms of infills with jibboards, so lighter things, but a very small level of earthquake, a very small level of drift, can actually lead to expensive damage, which whose repairing cost can be quite intensive. And then we have facades, heavy facades made of precast panels, which have unfortunately been proven to be a life-threatening issue. So we're discussing about life safety. We think it's a matter of structural skeleton, and we discover that the envelope can be life-threatening. So we need to protect, from a seismic point of view, the envelope for two reasons. Life-threatening, still a concern, and expenditure. The cost of repairing the envelope, so the dress of a building, is extremely high. If we think that the target, the code is not a target, is not the target objective of any design. So life safety is not the target, but it's the minimum that by law. Here is where makes sense all the presentation that we've been giving to present those to the policymakers, to the decision makers, and explain that with a tiny more, a bigger percentage of cost, initial cost, you're going to have a massive savings, and the savings are for taxpayers. It's improvement of safety, which means benefits directly to the population, improvement of resilience of the community, because you do not have the downtime and the impact from a socio-economical point of view. In addition to that is a safety, is a reduction of expenditure, which the taxpayer would be paying, regardless of them being national level or rate payers from a city council level. So the corollary, the consequence is that we think earthquake resistance, but people think earthquake proof. People, the population is absolutely convinced that we should be delivering a seismic resistant, meaning an earthquake proof building. And they got very surprised when things went wrong under the recent earthquakes, where buildings stayed up. They made their job, so they basically respected the life safety target, but it was not possible to repair them, and the consequence for the population was very high. Since much earlier than 2010 and 2011 earthquake sequence in New Zealand, we've been pushing to move raising the bar of expectation, sorry, raising the bar of performance target, such that we can really respect and meet the expectations of the society. And the pushing back to the left-hand side basically means having a better performance, have a damage control level of performance for new building for sure, but also for existing buildings. When we are retrofitting, we need to move up. What happened in New Zealand? The earthquake was, remember, 25% of GDP, something that is not sustainable for a country from the point of view of the whole socio-economical sustainability. And so basically a new scheme, a new mandatory framework for seismic risk reduction was introduced in 2017. Why 5 years later? Because it took us in the earthquake engineering community quite a number of years to move up the seismic protocol, the assessment protocol. Taiwan was mentioning about initial seismic assessment, detailed seismic assessment, the American, European, let's say, Japanese, China, Taiwan approach, New Zealand and South America have all the same approach, basically two or three tiers level, possibly an initial seismic assessment and then a detailed seismic assessment. New Zealand introduced a mandatory requirement for which every private building, with the exception of timber dwellings, must be within a certain amount of time assessed with a new protocol, seismic assessment guidelines produced in the 2017, within a time frame that depends on the, I wished it could have been the risk. Instead, it's depending on the hazard. It's okay, not bad. It would have been better to have a risk-based, really a risk-based approach. So a combination of hazard and the vulnerability of the building gives you a priority, a prioritization, and then you will be then assessing retrofitting as fast as possible, the most consequence-based dangerous ones, not only the one in the higher seismic region. And based on that, this started with basically a new protocol. We need to think about us becoming medical engineers. As per medical engineering, as per the medical protocol, there are different tiers. And as per medical people, there are diagnosis, prognosis, and then therapies. Same thing we are doing when we are doing an assessment, and then we are doing a prognosis. It's basically the analysis of a building to understand the behavior under the earthquake pre and post, before and after the retrofitting. And then we need to make absolutely the evaluation of the therapy. So how much does it cost, cost benefit wise, not only cost of our retrofit intervention. The New Zealand approach had already introduced a seismic rating A, B, C, D, E. And that seismic rating was suggested that if your capacity divided by the demand, the capacity demand ratio is below 33%, then you need to move up, you're in the red zone. You need to move up to a higher level. The New Zealand Society of Earthquake Engineering suggested that 34% is not enough. You should move up as much as possible to 67, which means two-thirds of your capacity is two-thirds of the earthquake demand is your capacity. So you are not that far away from a relatively good building. What we've been developing is a mechanically based, so this is more for engineers, procedure that goes from component level, beams and columns, to beam column connection, and to look at the hierarchy of strength, the actual hierarchy of strength, after which we understand the local mechanism and the global mechanism. And this will be allowing us then to come out with by hand, literally by hand, analytically, which means by Excel, we don't need a software at this stage, a pushover able to tell us what is going to happen when. Basically, it's the diagnosis becoming the prognosis from a mechanical point of view. And from here on, if we wish, we can go to a computer model. But very important, the New Zealand guidelines have mandatorily imposed, enforced, the use of a by hand pushover analysis using what is called SLAMA, simplified lateral mechanism analysis, prior to touch any computer software. So you are, as an engineering, you are forced to go back to the understanding, and you really can come out with something very reliable, quite reliable considering the simplification of the method, which is still a nonlinear pushover, to determine the capacity versus the demand. And then you have the seismic rating. Here we are, A, B, C, D, E, F. Now, as soon as you have a seismic rating, it becomes quite normal to understand it's the same grading that you will give to a student or that anyone will be receiving, also in the energy efficiency point of view. And here comes the co-creation. I was ping-ponging between, in 2015, between New Zealand and Italy, and trying to explain to someone what was going on the other side. And we were trying to explain, explaining to colleagues and politicians what was going on in New Zealand in terms of mandatory requirements. And the Italian response from a cultural point of view was obviously, we cannot enforce. We have an existing stocks, think about not only the schools, but the residential buildings are too old, too vulnerable. We cannot enforce people to pay by their own because that was the New Zealand approach. So in New Zealand, vice versa, there were no financial incentives. And financial incentives, Santi, were in a country where we are not able to put a mandatory requirement, you can convince people to get to something for the goodness of everyone by financial incentives, which is something that Italy has used a lot, for example, not only for cars, for changing cars, but also scooters, but also, for example, heat pumps, everything that needs to have for the health of people and the wealth also of people needs to have financial incentives has been done. So the ping-ponging suggested that in Italy, financial incentives were introduced and suggested that in the mandatory could not be done. And in New Zealand, something like this happened. So looking at the Italian seismicity and the records, basically what we got, we don't have the seismicity of the Ring of Fire, for example. We have a lower seismicity, but a very high vulnerability. And the combination of the two give to our territory, the building stock, are extremely high risk. In a way, the Italian building stock is at higher risk than the New Zealand building stock, which is much younger, not as vulnerable as, but with a higher level of hazard, seismicity. So who governs very often the risk is the uncertainty and the bad behavior of the bad buildings. So it was mentioned about our reinforced masonry building that has been banned in New Zealand in 1930. Same thing happened in the United States. In Italy, our reinforced masonry building with proper detailing can still be built. The problem is that we have so many old ones. And here is the new introduction of the Italian code. Not only life safety has been introduced as a safety index for to decide the level of rating, but also the economical losses. The expected annual losses, which has been around in the research environment for a while, have become a mandatory index that you need to evaluate to understand whether your building is going to be economical or too expensive to repair. And the class, the seismic rating ABC is going to be the lower of the two. So when we have existing very flexible buildings, which is typical of the 1950 and 60 pre-70, obviously the expected annual losses due to the movement of the building, the drift, and due to the expenses of the repairing of the non-structural elements can be very high. So you need to strengthen it. And obviously jacketing walls like has been shown in the retrofit program in Taiwan makes sense. We don't dislike using braces. Base isolation, for example, in Italy after L'Aquila earthquake has been used a lot for repairing and strengthening. It's a matter of culture. If you have the technology available and the engineers can design it, why not? It's, at the end, it's a cost-benefit information. So very important, you see here the rating green to red is already perceived by people with the same rating of your fridge, literally your fridge or your washing machine, A, B, C, D, E, G, or your light bulb. And that's very intentional because the plan was to move with, first of all, financial incentives. So immediately in 2017, were introduced financial incentives in Italy, which are able to give you a quite fundamental, here we are, quite fundamental tax rebate up to 75 to 85%. You pay the money up front and then in 10 years, you recover back a significant amount, 75 to 85, depending on whether you are in a private house or in a condominium, and depending on whether you're moving up by one class from D one level up or from whatever to two level up. So the more you upgrade, the more benefits you get. Now, this has been important and people started thinking about that. Then in addition to that, new things happen. And I want to show you the researchers suggested that that's something that we've been putting on the plate, on the table of discussion. The cost of retrofitting to go to from A to B, to go from a class level to another class level is not the same. You can reach the same level of rating, but there is in terms of seismic risk, but you don't reach the same level of rating in terms of economics, so the expected annual losses. And that's exactly what was the missing point in New Zealand, which has been introduced in Italy. We are now trying to back, for example, in New Zealand to explain. The big novelty is that we've been pushing for a while of, in terms of receiving big push for sustainability, big push for Green Deal, European Green Deal 2050. I have a slide on climate change neutral, carbon neutral target. And to do that, energy efficiency of building is the target. But the northern part of Europe or the central northern part of Europe is not that seismic, or it's low seismic or no seismic. So they don't really perceive the importance of putting a new dress and on the top of a well retrofitted skeleton. This is a concern of Southern Europe, which will be a concern definitely of Mexico and all the regions of the same type of problems of seismicity combined with energy efficiency. So if you look at the seismic map and we put together the climate change, the climate map, not climate changes yet, the climate map, very cold in the Alps and becoming hotter in the sea level, and then we have the Apennines, so basically the mountains on the coast, which is where the buildings are the most vulnerable in a way, then we need to create a completely different way of acting as medical engineers. We are now very familiar with structural engineering and seismic. We typically don't do the design of energy efficiency. There are specialists that do during the energy efficiency, which are mechanical engineering or energy engineering. It's our duty as structural seismic to actually learn and try to put step by step everything together. If you look on the right hand side, the building is not anymore a frame. The building is a building system. From a population point of view, from a building system point of view, it's actually a combination of skeleton and envelope. And guess what? The dress, the envelope, what we call non-structural elements are exactly the most vulnerable elements in seismic design. They are exactly the type of target for an energy efficiency. The most important target of energy efficiency is to put thicker, more denser, more insulated type of layer. But if you use them as an add-on structural elements, they might be lost in a very small earthquake. So basically you're losing the taxpayer money very promptly. We've been discussing about the need to integrate seismic and energy efficiency intervention. So you need to do analysis seismic type, energy type, think about the intervention and then combining them, because it makes sense that the envelope will be the first one that you try to protect. To do that, we are now receiving the European Green Deal targets, which is really high level, but the target is extremely measurable. So the climate carbon neutral 2050 means a huge investment in terms of energy efficiency of building. And on the other hand, we need to really raise up the bar in terms of seismic risk. One of the first big changes has been with discussion or with the people who were taking care of the is the center, National Center for Energy, but now it's doing also innovation. It was the discussion about be careful that you cannot really push only for the Green Deal. You need to push also for the seismic. So they created an app. They created an app such that there's a general information. Here there are the energy efficiency, but also you see the structural information. If you have a system that you're thinking to retrofitting from an energy efficiency point of view, but the structural skeleton is dangerous, then you are not allowed to put a new dress. So you first need to fix the building and from the skeleton, from the seismic point of view, and then you will be allowed later on to do the energy, seismic energy efficiency intervention. This will suggest that in some cases, demolition and reconstruction is not a big deal anymore. It actually should be considered. And here is the target. We are discussing is not yet a plan. It's a suggestion for a plan. What we had high level workshops with members of the government and really a big group made of engineers, architecture, lawyers, economists. So who can actually put together a 30 years plan for an integrated rehabilitation of the building stock? It's not only schools, it's private building residential in schools. Clearly, schools have a high priority, definitely a very high priority, but schools are managed by mostly by the local authorities or the global or the national authorities, not by the private people. The point is, how can you arrange a proper plan such that on one hand you're spending taxpayers, on the other you're putting financial incentives? And look at the number, 0.2-0.3% of the GDP, gross domestic product, is what we suggest being a fair number as a start to push for a really rehabilitation of the building stock. Sergio, I'm not able to see my screen to see the countdown, how many minutes I have, if any.
You have a couple of minutes.
Couple of minutes, I go fast. 2002, that was a major disaster, catastrophe. A school in San Giuliano di Puglia collapsed and a full class of 25 young primary school kids plus the teacher died. After that, a national plan started in 2003. And then after the 2009 earthquake in L'Aquila, a new plan for safe school, seismic school. The problem was that the plan was interesting, but the money was not enough. And now people are understanding, so from the bottom up, that we need to use more taxpayers' money. And so we started a study with, for example, the province of Foggia, which is in the southeast. And we look at potentially paid by Europe, Green Deal, energy efficiency. We said, honestly, let's try to look at how we can integrate the energy efficiency of schools with seismic safety. There's no point of doing the dress without having done the skeleton. So we look at basically 60 schools, huge amount of work for 2 years with a big team of collaborators, an exceptional amount of work doing the visits, understanding what's going on, taking the bills of the energy and the thermal bills from the schools, doing the energy efficiency evaluation, targeting and coming up with an intervention that could have been a combination of standard intervention for energy efficiency combined with potential intervention for seismic, and showing that if you do an integrated combination, the cost is going to be extremely lower when compared to making the two separately, or just a little bit more when compared to making only one. This is just for your reference. You could go and see, it's in Italian, but from a Spanish point of view, you can understand it's been recorded. It's a workshop with the presidency of the Presidenza del Consiglio dei Ministri, so the Council of Ministry of Italy and the representation of the presidency. Basically, we managed to have a workshop discussing the big plan, what would be a big plan for rehabilitation, seismic and energy efficiency intervention, looking at condominiums, residential multi-story, schools, as well as a portion of cities. There are three different levels and they are extremely important. I need to finish off, so I want to go to the final and I have a video, so allow me for that. We need to have an opportunity. We do have an opportunity. We have a duty to think about retrofitting schools with new technology as much as possible, including exoskeleton, which can look like low damage rocking system, as well as demolition and reconstruction. We take lessons learned from our ancient rocking system. We've been working for 20 years, a lot on that. In New Zealand, there's a huge amount of showcases after the before and even after the earthquake of these type of buildings. I'll give you in the slides, you can look at the references. We've been also organizing conferences. And then the big target, only two slides and one video, is how can we introduce all of this in Europe, where people are more conservative, and Europe is Europe. It's not only Italy, Greece, and Portugal, which are the most seismic country. So we pushed for something unique, for a big project where we were going to test a 3D shaking table test in Lisbon on the full building system, the skeleton and the envelope. And imagine in the envelope would be a seismic energy efficiency envelope. You can find all about this project over here, including a long video. I just want to show you the slides about the test, and after that, I'm done. We are on a shaking table. If you can see it, hopefully. If it doesn't appear, can you see it? I don't think so.
No.
No, you can't.
Don't see.
No problem. Sorry for that.
Don't worry about it.
No worry. You go, please, and see it. Basically, the point is that we were able to shake under a basically collapse prevention big earthquake, and we were able almost be able to have a very low negligible level of damage, including non-structural elements. The cost of the idea is to monitor all these buildings like we are typically doing. We have already done that in the new technology in New Zealand. So they are all monitored like you would be doing for a car. And if you think about the cost, I don't go to the details, but just imagine the evolution in phones, evolution in computer, evolution in buildings, they perform much more, and the cost is much lower. The only problem is that we don't know about building technology being available to this extent of technology. Thank you very much for your patience, and Sergio, again, for the invitation. It's an exceptional workshop. Thanks.
Muchas gracias, Stefano. Nos ha recordado la importancia de los reglamentos, que son documentos mínimos de seguridad, no son el objetivo mismo. Y así como también nos has recordado que los ingenieros tenemos que tratar, y los arquitectos, no con estructuras, sino con el edificio en general. Muchísimas gracias. Ojalá te puedas quedar con nosotros para el panel que será dentro de una hora a las 12:15 de México. Un poco tarde en Italia, 7:15 de la noche.
I will stay here. I will be here.
Muchas gracias.